Before we start this video, I would just like to say that there will be spoilers for the following shows, so be wary of that. Likewise, there will be discussions of suicide and sexual assault, so please continue watching at your own discretion. The American teen television show 13 Reasons Why has been hailed as a show which accurately depicts a range of serious issues facing modern teenagers, such as suicide, bullying, and sexual assault. The show premiered on March 31st, 2017, on Netflix with a predictable 13 episodes, one for each reason why Hannah Baker committed suicide. I remember reading the book that the first season is based on when I was like in ninth grade and only like 14 years old. And I thought John Green novels were basically at that time, like the novels like The Fault in Our Stars and Paper Towns were basically the peak of YA, which 23-year-old Andrea is like, please, I would scoff at that today. And that's not to hate on these books per se, especially because I do think a lot of them, not a lot, but most of them, a good amount of them, including like Paper Towns, for example, still holds up fairly well today. But I just simply don't gravitate towards contemporary YA literature anymore, so it's just not what I'm into. However, at the time of my first read, I truly, really thought 13 Reasons Why was such a powerful novel, as well as just an overall important story to tell. Now, this opinion on the original source material has also changed. Like, it's, as I've grown up, it's just changed. My beliefs have grown up, right? But I still do believe that the book is far better in terms of representation than the Hell series that it spawned, right? Therefore, this video is not going to focus too much on the book, but instead on the 2017 series, specifically that first season. For background, as if you didn't already know by clicking on this video, the first season of 13 Reasons Why mostly follows the story of Hannah Baker, played by the very talented Katherine Langford. Loved her in Knives Out. The story begins with Hannah having already committed suicide prior to the pilot, and our main character, who's Clay Jensen, played by Dylan Minnette, who you might recognize from his very famous role as Claire's little brother Todd in the Click movies. But Clay finds a box of cassette tapes on his front doorstep, basically. Soon he finds out, alongside the audience, which is us really, that these cassette tapes were actually sent by the recently deceased Hannah Baker prior to her suicide. There are seven official tapes in total, with six of them having double sides, so it kind of adds up, right? Which are supposed to be the 13 reasons why Hannah Baker killed herself. Throughout the first, or throughout the rest of the first season, the audience follows Clay basically as he listens to the tapes, and we learn about all the events that led up to her killing herself, as well as how it has affected those around her who she's left tapes for. That is all I want to say for now, right? But I'll obviously go more into detail and discussion later on in this video. However, before we get into the issues of how suicide is depicted in 13 Reasons Why, I do first want to offer up a point of comparison that I feel is oft talked about and is really like the biggest basis for this video. 5 years prior to the release of the series, the Canadian teen television show Degrassi, right, which is one of my favorite shows of all time, also offered audiences a suicide storyline during its 12th, yes, you heard me right, 12th season, right, with through the character of Campbell Saunders, played by the brilliant Dylan Everett. So for context, like I said, Degrassi is my favorite show of all time. Not necessarily because it's the best show I've ever seen and nothing else compares, right? It's not up there with like Westworld people. But it's more so my favorite show because of the impact it has had on me, like growing up. It's kind of shaped me into who I am today, kind of similar to Glee, which is equally like, what even is that show? And therefore, Degrassi will always hold the most specialist of places in my heart. I know it's not a word, but deal with it. However, because this show is my favorite, I also remember watching the trailers for the new seasons whenever they came out, which like season 12 had such a good trailer. The Bite Your Tongue was their second best trailer, not obviously still paling in comparison to the season 10 Shark in the Water. But anyway, I remember watching that trailer for season 12 and being so excited, and I especially remember becoming like instantaneously enamored with the new character of Campbell Saunders and especially his potential relationship with Maya. Once the season actually aired part A during the summer, like which was called Degrassi Showdown, right? My love was like 100% officially cemented, and they're even probably, I would say, you know, like they are definitely like my second favorite Degrassi pairing from seasons like 8 to 14, hands down. They're my favorite. I've stated that in a prior video. Specifically, however, though, like to be very, very real, I really just fell in love with Cam. I found him very relatable and very grounded as a character. Once part B aired, things became murkier for the character as more focus was placed on his like deteriorating mental health and internal issues. Then by the time the final part C premiere aired, the suicide storyline unfortunately came to its like natural conclusion. The rest of the season focuses primarily on the effect this death has had on different characters who were all related to his suicide in some form or another, as well as how differently people deal with this trauma. Therefore, it can be said that both of these shows dealt with a similar storyline, right? And they both also spent time focusing on how this singular event affected the lives of so many others. However, clearly, the degree of care that was given in both of these shows differs immensely, and that's what I'll primarily be discussing today. So settle in, get some hot Cheetos or whatever, because this is going to be a long video. Before I begin ranting and go in on this show, I do want to state that I am not a medical professional in any capacity, right? Crazy, crazy concept. But I literally went to university to read books and write essays, okay? Therefore, I can't sit here and say that like 13 Reasons Why is only bad and has never had any positive side effects to any communities ever. In fact, while doing research for this video, I did even find some evidence which, like agreed that 13 Reasons Why does have some beneficial factors to it. Like some stated that the show was harmful, yes, and led to a rise in suicide ideation, but others did state the opposite and actually stated that the show increased searches for suicide prevention. However, for this video, I really want to focus on the fact that even if the show like increased conversations around prevention and mental health, it still portrayed the issue in such a detrimental way. That we should talk about it and we should be able to criticize it openly. So, with that out of the way, let's get into the meat and potatoes. There are two major flaws that need to be discussed in regards to how the show failed. The first is the harmful portrayal of mental health that season one especially provided, and the potential implications this can have on a younger demographic. The second I want to focus on, the second flaw, is how the show consciously decided to uphold shock value for the sake of ratings over actual representation that could benefit its audience. There is something called contagion theory, which basically tries to explain collective behavior, how individuals can be influenced or even hypnotized by the crowd majority. French doctor Gustave Le Bon, am I saying that right? Probably not. held the belief that contagion was one of the three stages of crowd psychology, which stated that individuals tend to follow the crowd. In other words, we can thank him for parents' favorite catch line, "If all your friends jumped off a bridge, would you do it too?" Thanks, Mom. I say all of this in order to explain suicide contagion, which, according to the US Department of Health and Human Services, is that exposure to suicide or suicidal behaviors within one's family, one's peer group, or through media reports of suicide can result in an increase in suicide and suicidal behaviors. Copycat suicides are a real phenomenon and have an actual history. Published in 1774, The Sorrows of Young Werther is a German novel written by Johann Wolfgang von Goethe, maybe. Also, don't know how to say any of these names, I'm so sorry. But the plot of the novel is basically an unrequited love triangle, right? Which ends with the titular Werther killing himself in order to end his pining love. So basically, just imagine Twilight, but instead of imprinting on a baby and grooming her, Jacob just killed himself instead, right? And like did us all a favor. But after the novel's release, it was insanely popular to the point that young German men were dressing up as Werther, and some were even going as far to kill themselves in the same fashion that Werther did in the novel. As a result, over the past 200 plus years, many debates have been had over this phenomenon and what measures should be taken in order to prevent such incidents. This only further confounds me as to why Netflix decided to ignore this for 13 Reasons Why and instead show an extremely graphic suicide scene on their platform. Prior to releasing the show in 2017, Netflix did the responsible thing and discussed the show's content with mental health experts who told them that suicide should not be shown because of its potential implications. And then they decided to do the irresponsible thing and ignore everything that they were told. But the question is why? Unfortunately, the answer is kind of obvious to me. In his article on the matter, Marco Scalvini states entertainment media might also have a specific marketing interest to create a controversy, provoke emotional reactions, and at the same time raise awareness. On the other hand, by continuing to produce such content, they might ignore concerns of parents, school counselors, and mental health experts. This is the root problem with utilizing real issues that should be discussed, such as suicide, for entertainment value. However, as Kimberly O'Brien states, this immersion into the story and images may have a particularly strong effect on adolescents, whose brains are still developing the ability to inhibit certain emotions, desires, and actions. Thus, the team behind the project has to decide whether they are going to prioritize gritty realism for the sake of being controversial, or maybe provide a watered-down version of reality that might be more beneficial for its target audience, but bring in, less buzz or whatever. The main reason that I had to personally stop watching the show 13 Reasons Why midway into season 2 was for this primary reason, plus the fact that it was kind of boring as hell to me at this point. But truly, even before the graphic season 2 finale scene that everyone and their mother was talking about, and which created equal controversy, I felt that personally there was no reason for the show to continue after the first season because at that point it would almost be like trauma, like the Trauma Olympics. Even though I did stop watching the show, I did still continue to hear what happened in the subsequent seasons, which, like, for me only further proves this. After deciding to drop the show and then being told about Tyler's graphic rape scene in the end of the second season, I was like so happy that I had discontinued watching because I felt disgusted. And I would like to clarify that I was not disgusted at the fact that they had that storyline because, like, again, it's an important one to have and it's important representation. However, I was more disgusted at the fact that traumatic experiences and moments such as those, which perhaps audience members could relate to, were being used as climactic plot points and cliffhangers to keep the watcher interested for the next season. This new knowledge then made me go back and reevaluate the entire first season as well, especially Hannah's death scene. The scene in question is a 3-minute long scene in which Hannah gets into her bathtub, fully clothed, filled it up with water, and then uses razors to slit her wrist. As someone who does not get super squeamish easily and has seen a plethora of the works that are in those disturbing movie icebergs, I genuinely still had to cover my eyes and look away during this scene. However, my body still automatically reacted because the sound of Langford's screams of pain and agony during this scene are very, extremely, extremely hard to listen to. All around, the scene is one of the hardest things I just had to listen to, since after watching like the initial deep cut into her skin, I had to look away. So, for anyone who has like read the books the way that I have, then you know that Hannah's suicide was actually due to an overdose of pills in the original source material. Therefore, it becomes quite clear, at least to me, that this was a conscious choice in order to depict a purposely graphic death scene and elicit like the most controversy possible. I would love to believe that like it was done for another reason, perhaps to raise awareness and nothing else. However, there are two faults to this argument. One being that an overdose would have been like would have equally raised a conversation, right, without it needing to be so visual. And second being that, as I mentioned earlier, experts literally told them beforehand not to do this. Therefore, it goes back to what I mentioned earlier. It was a strategy, which is the fundamental issue with the show 13 Reasons Why. It's not attempting to tell a genuinely well-done story about mental health issues and suicide, but a show with enough shock value that people will talk about and ultimately just want to watch it. This was enough of a bad decision that 2 years later, in the summer of 2019, Netflix publicly came out and announced that it had cut the controversial scene from the show altogether. According to the streaming platform, because the show was attracting new viewers every season watching the show for the first time, and due to conversations they had with mental health experts, they decided it would be the best decision for the show moving forward. However, Netflix might have been well-intentioned in attempting to do this, but it really means nothing to me when they had already had these conversations prior to the show's release and decided to wait an entire 2 years after the show had already premiered before doing anything about it. At this point, a majority of the people who were ever going to watch this show probably already had seen the scene. And even if something happens in later years and this show gets a huge like re-emergence in the popular culture, people will still have access to this scene somewhere else besides Netflix. There are likely like DVD box sets out there that were distributed and purchased prior to this decision, which have the unedited scene. It's almost as if they already got like what they wanted from that scene, which was buzz and views. And so now they decided to axe it once it had already done what they needed it to financially. Therefore, this late decision really holds no impact and only really further solidifies that Netflix knew what they were doing and knew that it could have like potentially be harmful to certain young groups, but that just was not their priority. According to Skillviny, there are four questions which should be asked when developing shows that discuss such heavy topics and matters. One, has the producer provided a proper warning so that every person can decide if they will reject the content or not? Two, is self-harm represented as an inevitable or desirable result or a solution to personal challenges? Three, is it necessary to include a detailed graphic image of self-harm? And four, is there any better use for self-harm in the plot or script? In regards to the first question, I think it could be said that yes, the show did provide proper warnings in two ways. In the marketing for the show, it was made very obvious what the show was going to be about in regards to the suicide of Hannah Baker. Likewise, certain episodes that are especially graphic did include warnings beforehand, even during the initial viewing, I remember. However, in regards to the third question, I think the answer should be obvious, which is that it's not necessary or beneficial for that matter to include a detailed graphic image of self-harm, especially not in the name of garnering viewership and controversial success. Utilizing the four questions posed, I now want to focus on the second and the fourth question, respectively, while I move on to my second strife with this show, which is the poor mishandling of mental health issues. If the show is to be believed, Hannah Baker killed herself not because of an underlying mental illness that might have been present, but because of how her classmates bullied and harassed her before eventually leading to her assault.
Bullying. Knock it off.
While I do not want to minimize the real-life damage and trauma that some of her classmates, such as the living and walking piece of trash Bryce Walker, put her through, this viewpoint in itself minimizes so many important conversations in regards to suicide and mental health awareness. In her aptly named article, 13 Reasons to Be Concerned About 13 Reasons Why, child and adolescent psychiatrist Sansi L. Jacobson writes about the major ways in which the show falls short. I wholeheartedly agree with everything that she wrote, but for the purpose of this section, I want to focus specifically on her second and third reasons in order to address the questions posed earlier. Foremost, she states the show focuses on blaming others as opposed to recognizing that greater than 90% of individuals who complete suicide are actually struggling with mental illness. Secondly, she says it downplays the cognitive distortions of depression and instead repeatedly suggests that suicide was the protagonist's rational choice in order to escape the emotional pain caused by others or perhaps more provocatively, to take revenge on those who wronged her. Let's start by unpacking that first reason, that the show focuses far too much on blaming others, which can obviously be seen with the infamous tapes that are at the center of the show. The tapes virtually act as a suicide chainmail spam, with each side containing one of the reasons why she decided to kill herself. The problem here is that each side corresponds to a specific character in the story, although sometimes it can double up, and it's ultimately Hannah just telling them each, post-death, that they are a reason that she has committed suicide. This allows the blame of her decision to be placed solely on the hands of those who received the tapes, instead of on Hannah herself. And now, I'm not trying to say that Hannah is to necessarily blame for what happened to her, because that is just not true, right? But she should be blamed for her suicide. It was her choice. But by placing the focus of the show on blaming others who were unable to be there for her, instead of addressing any potential mental health issues which Hannah most likely had, the show is sending a wrong message about what leads to someone choosing to kill themselves, and if we can even really call it a choice to begin with. Now, let's address her second reason, specifically that 13 Reasons Why downplays the mental health aspects in favor of showing the suicide as a rational choice or as revenge. Going back to the basic plot of the show's freshman season, every single tape was carefully and calmly recorded by Hannah prior to killing herself, as was the entire plan of having it sent from person to person like a chain. This is the first issue. The show makes Hannah's choice appear like it took great thinking out and planning, maybe even happening throughout the course of a few days. However, in reality, suicide is usually more than anything a very sudden, impulsive decision that one doesn't typically plan out as meticulously and evil as Hannah did in the series. Because that's something we need to emphasize. What Hannah did was evil, and that should be discussed more. Minus perhaps Bryce and Justin's second tape. The tapes not only come off as petty revenge a lot of the time, they also just played into that sick suicidal revenge fantasy of a victim finally getting the ultimate say on her bullies. If you remember the second question that Scalvini presented, he stated that something producers should ask themselves is if the self-harm is depicted as a desirable result. With everything I have just said, I believe the answer should obviously be yes. This show used self-harm and suicide not as a way to promote awareness or real mental health issues, but as a way to let Hannah give the biggest and most victorious middle finger to everyone in her life who didn't live up to what she needed them to be, which is not the right message to be sending to what is ultimately a show with predominantly a younger demographic. I'm not going to attempt to self-diagnose Hannah Baker myself, because I'm just like not the person to do that. But it's been written by many actual experts that at the bare minimum, Hannah did possibly display signs of depression, right? However, the show never bothers to address this or address any further potential mental health diagnosis when it comes to her character, which is truly where the show failed completely. With so many people tuning in to watch, and I promise you, there were so many people excited for the show to be released. Because let me tell you that I remember the excitement before this show's first season came out. I literally binged the entire season in one sitting in my little single dorm bed freshman year. And everyone I knew had watched it by the first weekend that it was out. So no matter what, the viewership was going to be fairly high. And they could have really used this for their advantage to create a conversation around mental health awareness and suicide prevention. However, instead, we're now having conversations about the ethical obligations producers have when creating forms of entertainment media, and just how detrimental graphic and inaccurate depictions of suicide can be to vulnerable watchers. But now that this rant is over, though, let's please move on to a better example of suicide in a teenage television show that needs more recognition. In the 12th season of the Canadian teen show Degrassi, a handful of new characters are introduced to cause some trouble. Among these fresh faces is the adorable sophomore hockey player Campbell Saunders. Prior to joining the show, actor Dylan Everett was told his role would only be for one season. Naturally, this made sense and didn't really raise any eyebrows with viewers since his character was not supposed to be actually from Toronto and he was just staying with a host family in order to attend Degrassi, right, and play with the Ice Hounds. Therefore, the way his character was set up, it honestly totally made sense for him to eventually leave the show once his storyline was wrapped up, and that's what I personally believed was going to happen. However, what no one could have expected is that his storyline would end in a tragic suicide. From his introduction, he is seen to be quite gentle and sensitive at times, such as in Say It Ain't So Part 2, when he accidentally stumbles into the girls' restroom in order to splash some water on his face after a public humiliation thanks to Bianca. Later on, when Bianca catches him in the restroom and threatens to tell the principal, he quickly breaks down crying to her about how sad he is that his hockey team hates him and how homesick he is. A few episodes later, in the two-part Rusty Cage episodes, we really start to see Campbell's proclivity for self-harm. In order to avoid hockey practice, we first see Campbell drink milk on purpose in order to make himself sick, which might seem harmless, but shows that he clearly doesn't mind putting himself in pain. This is then amplified during a breakdown towards the end of the episode when he accidentally slices his hand with his skates, but then seems to enjoy the pain. By the end of the two-parter, Cam purposely throws himself off the edge of the second floor railing in school in order to, on purpose, break his arm, fully cementing not only that, yes, he has a tendency to self-harm, but also shows that he clearly has underlying issues. I mention all of this in order to provide context and show the slow progression of Cam's story throughout the season. This is crucial because even though Cam is never shown to have explicitly stated suicidal thoughts before, it is important to show that he clearly had issues which would have made him more vulnerable to such a decision. While similar to Hannah in that Cam is not officially diagnosed by anyone, it can be assumed likewise that he had a mixture of anxiety problems with depression. These issues come to a head in the final 8 episodes of the season, excluding the graduation special at the end. And this is where I now want to go into my final section and compare the two series. The third part of season 12 of Degrassi premiered on February 15th, 2013, with the episode everyone knew was coming, Bittersweet Symphony Part 1. At this point, everyone in the fandom knew there was going to be a suicide and that it was most likely going to be Cam, but our suspicions weren't confirmed officially until the episode aired. The first episode itself is a seemingly normal episode, but it's really just the calm before the storm. Sprinkled throughout the episode are different interactions Cam has with different characters, from important characters in Cam's story, like fellow classmate Dallas, to mere acquaintances like Allie. By the end of the episode, the audience is even confused about whether or not Cam is going to be the one to die because things seem to actually be working out for him for once, and he seems happier than ever. However, it's Cam's final conversation on the show ever, which happens to be with Zig, that becomes a straw that breaks the camel's back, so to say. To summarize very quickly, Zig tells Cam that he's a psycho and that the best thing he could do for his girlfriend at the time, Maya, is stay far away from her, forever. In my personal opinion, this is the best decision Degrassi could have made in terms of Cam's final straw. No one else on the show could have twisted a deeper knife than Zig, who Cam was already insecure about when it came to Maya due to a messy love triangle previously. Now, this is where I would like to begin my Venn diagram comparison between the two shows. Cam never blames his suicide explicitly on Zig for this conversation, nor does he leave some kind of written note that says, "Zig, you are my reason why." And that is because this isn't really needed. Zig already blames himself and knows that what he said was wrong. Later on in the final episodes of that season, he has his own storyline where he breaks down because of how much guilt he's carrying around with him, and he comes to the correct realization that it isn't right to blame himself for this. While their conversation might have been the catalyst for the event, it was not the sole reason. If it weren't for this moment, then it would have been something else that would have eventually led Cam to come to the same decision. Likewise, both shows touch on how suicide does not solely affect the one person, but everyone around them too, With the reactions of Zig, Maya, Dallas, and Eli, the audience is able to experience the different variations of grief that different people can feel, regardless of whether or not they knew Cam personally or not. This is similar to 13 Reasons Why, with the big difference again being that Degrassi never attempts to make it seem like it was Zig or Dallas's fault that Cam committed suicide, even though those two characters were arguably the harshest on Cam. Now, let's discuss the actual meat of both storylines, which is the suicides themselves. As previously discussed, 13 Reasons Why shows that Hannah planned out her suicide enough to record 13 tapes and send them out for revenge before actually even doing the deed. On the other hand, Cam was on an emotional high, as I previously mentioned. His life was finally looking up for him. However, after his conversation with Zig, it appeared as if a switch had flipped off in his head and his decision was made right there and then. After this, we never saw him again. He never left a note for anyone. He didn't even really break up with his girlfriend properly in person. But that was the point. Suicide is not supposed to be something that one plans out most of the time, but it's actually an impulsive, in-the-moment decision. More importantly, however, the creators of Degrassi likewise got in contact with mental health experts prior to beginning work on the suicide storyline and were unsurprisingly given the same advice that Netflix would have been given a few years later. The major difference here is that the team behind Degrassi actually decided to do the responsible thing and listen to the professionals. Crazy thought, I know. As a result, there are two major differences in how Cam's suicide is portrayed. For starters, we never see the actual suicide scene, nor do we see the dead body afterwards. Even better, we never get an official confirmation of the method he used to kill himself, although it can easily be speculated based off small hints in later episodes. This might not have provided the shock and wow factor that some streaming platforms so desperately wanted, but it was ultimately the safest and best decision the showrunners could have made. Overall, I think that Degrassi is a prime example of how it is possible to formulate entertaining and equally quality television that depicts real issues such as teen suicide, but in a, conscientious manner that raises awareness without sacrificing the well-being of vulnerable youth groups. As well, it's a clear example that whenever you're creating something with the intention of wanting to tell a genuine and realistic storyline that could hopefully prevent similar events from occurring, you make a much better story than when you're just trying to show extreme scenes for the sake of controversy. I will not negate the conversations that 13 Reasons Why has been able to initiate, such as this long video I myself have made today. However, I still hold true that the show could have done so much more than it did in the beginning, but unfortunately, its priorities were not in trying to provide good or accurate representation, but in creating an entertaining and grim outlook on adolescence that would get as many possible people to watch. And that's the sad part, really. When producers value ratings over actual good content, we get trash like 13 Reasons Why.